Praise Jesus. Welcome to the continuation of our study. And we will start off with the hymn for today, which is Trust and Obey by John Samis. So let's please sing it then. So this has a story, and then the hymn can be found in the playlist of the song. So it's just there, and you can actually find it all over there. So the story is here. Just click it and paste it there. All right, so the author of the song is, the writer is John Samis, then the music writer is Daniel Towner, and it was written in 1887. Those are about over 100 years ago. So I'll just read it. So it says, one night at a D.L. Moody, Dwight L. Moody evangelistic meeting in Brockton, Massachusetts, a young man stood up to testify about his confidence of salvation. He said, and I quote, "I am not sure," meaning that he wasn't really certain that God would save him from his sins. And then he continued, "But I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey," meaning that he planned to trust God for his salvation and to do what he could to obey God's will. I'm going to trust and I'm going to obey. Daniel Towner was a song leader for that meeting. He was so impressed by the young man's testimony that he wrote down those words and stuck them in his pocket. Later, he wrote a friend, John Samis. In his letter, he told about the young man's testimony and included the young man's words. I am not quite sure, but I am going to trust and I'm going to obey. Then, as his history is that the song was then developed. This is a beautiful story. Number one, which is close to our hearts, is that this is a young person. He's a young man, young woman, you know, he's young, yeah? He's a young man. And the second thing is that God had saved this young man, and we see it in his testimony. We see it because of his resolve. Alikuwa ameamua kumtumainia Mungu. Mungu amuokoe, and we'll see this actually coming out in today's study. And he was determined to obey, which is the fruit of a heart that is trusting. You see, we cannot see trust. No one can see trust. We can't see it. It exists. It's in the heart, just like the way we can't see gravity. We just see the effects of gravity. So one of the ways to see or to know whether we trust the Lord is by obeying him. And so we see this man, this young man, young, wonderful, wonderful testimony to us, is a true, true, true picture of what we should be, what we are, and what we are growing more and more to be. And that is people who trust the Lord. And that trust is seen in our obedience of God, which is very beautiful. So let this encourage us as young men that God is in the business of saving young people. God does not frown upon it. And his story is one of them. And then just think about the impact of this young man. You know, he's just a young man. Probably hata hakujua ati hii wimbo ilikuwa based on him. I don't know. We are not told that in the story. But Kenya nataka uone ni that, you know, impact ya who young man. We are singing a song that came out of his testimony. Not directly, but, you know, if he would not have given the testimony, then we would not have the song probably. And so it's a wonderful promise that God will see to it that his work is done, and he can use anyone, even when you're not intending for anything to come out of it. But so long as God is in it, you know, he was testifying about what? His confidence of salvation. So he was testifying about what God has done. God brought out. God brought it out, and it is a blessing to us 100 years plus later. And we thank God for it. So let's ask him to be with us. Lord Father, we thank you. We bless your name. We ask that you would open our eyes to see you. Open our eyes to see Jesus through the reading and study and consideration of your word. We ask that you would enlighten us, O Holy Spirit, that we may do all and see rightly as you show us, and do all to the glory of your name. We depend upon you. We lift up our souls to you, O Lord, that you may feed us, that you may satisfy us to the praise and glory of your name and our good. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's continue where we left off. And to start us off, we'll just recite what we did yesterday. And I'd encourage you to have two quick encouragements. One is, I encourage you to go through the verses over and over again. What we'll be doing is that we'll be writing them down. So, for example, to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. Mm-hmm. So every day we'll be writing what we have studied so far. So if you've studied five of them, we'll just try and remember. God will help us, and we'll write all of them because we want to store up God's word in our heart. We want to memorize it. And that is something that God will help us do because he has attached a blessing to it. You know, say, blessed is a man who does not. But what does that man do in someone? He meditates on the word of God day and night, you know, and that's what we want. It is easy to meditate on what you've memorized. So I encourage you to do this. For me, I have a physical book, so you can do that. So you can write on the physical book just the verses as we go along them. You make notes what God is showing you, what you are learning. And also, there's an app that I will also share in the comment sections called Fighter Verses that you can also install. It's something you have to buy, and it's about 300 bob. And I encourage you to buy it. And I know God will provide for you according to his riches in glory. So get it. It's much easier because you can then even memorize when ukiwa kwa mat, unaweza memorize ukitake walks, unatoa tu phone, si lazima na kitabu, unatoa tu kasimu. It's 300 bob. One of the things I would encourage you to do is to ask your parents to show you. I mean, ask your parents to just finance that. If that may not be possible, I encourage you to save for it, because you can set aside money based on how your budget is, and you can buy it in the long run. It's just 300 bob, and nasi monthly subscription, one off. So I encourage you to do that as we try and memorize. So we looked at this yesterday. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. Then for today's, it is on, O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. So again, we just write it. It helps to write. So, O my God, in you I trust. See, in you I trust. I'm trying to remember. Let's confirm that. O my God, I think I need to. Where is it? Oh, it has gone. It's here. Oh my God, in you I trust. And then let me not be put to shame. Let me not be put to shame. So let me not be put to shame. And then I think it's let not my enemies triumph over me. No, let not my enemies exalt over me. Let not my enemies exalt over me. So, yeah, let's just pen that down. Let not my enemies exalt over me. So let not my enemies exalt over me. Good. So just write it. Again, it's a way of memorizing. You write it down, you speak it. And more and more, the more and more you do this, the more and more we will remember. So let's do again similar to what we have been doing. Let's try and see these different words, then the words that we probably might not understand, then we look at what the Lord has for us today. So the first thing is, let's see it in Swahili. So in Swahili ni E Mungu wangu nimekutumaini wewe nisiaibike adui zangu wasifurahi kwa kunishinda. Okay, that's the Swahili version. E Mungu wangu, oh my God, nimekutumainia wewe. In you I trust. Nisiaibike, let me not be put to shame, and adui zangu wasifurahi kwa kunishinda. Let not my enemies exult over me. So kwa English, I think the thing that we can notice ni that kuna different word that inatumiwa by the psalmist for God. Kumbuka the first verse alitumia Lord, and tuliangalia hiyo. Then hapa tunaona ingine, so tunaona God. So na hii tutaangalia ni word gani kwa ile transliteration yenye tulikuwa tunafuata, this one here. So that word for God is Elohim. So unaona in the beginning he uses the word Yahweh. Then in the second verse we have the word Elohim. Okay, so it's good to notice those changes because it brings out the meaning more because David is a person who knew all the words, so he chose. It's not an accident, they are there by God's design. Then so we look at that in a few minutes, Elohim. So that's one thing that we need to look at. Then maybe the other thing that we also need to think about ni the idea of shaming. Okay, shaming, I think na Kiswahili hapo imetusaidia hii nini ni aibu, okay, ama kuaibika. Okay, so shame, but we look at an English definition. Then exalt over me ni kushindwa. Okay, kushindwa. We thank God for our language because it, I mean it, naelewa haraka sana. So kushindwa, usikubali nishindwe na nani, na maadui. Enemies is okay. Then shame ni aibu. Then oh my God. So acha tuanze na oh my God, Elohim. So for this I already looked for the references, and I will share the links. I'll share the links in the description section. Then unaweza soma, because some of them are quite long. Kama hii ni refu, so we cannot really go through it. But nita highlight the different sections that are relevant, just to make a distinction between Yahweh and Elohim as far as it is used. So the first one here is that we are seeing that most authorities agree that Elohim is derived from El, meaning mighty one, strong or strength. And then the Hebrew ending im added to El indicates plurality, so ni wingi. And there is also this one here from Grace to You, a sermon by Reverend John MacArthur, where he says that it is trying to expound the same. So he talks about Elohim in this sermon. I've also shared the description. I've also shared the link in the description section. Unaweza angalia the whole, hata unaweza sikiza the whole sermon. I encourage you to do that. So he says that Genesis 1 says, in the beginning God, and the word for God is Elohim. So it's the same word we are seeing in us in oh my God, it's oh my Elohim. And anytime there is im, okay, so I am ending on the, pardon, I think I lost my reading. And anytime there is an im, that is, I am ending on the end of a Hebrew word, it's a plural. Okay, it's like S in English. So the way you have, he gives an example, dogs, cats, etc. So it's plural. Im is plural. So in the beginning, God's plural. And yet it's singular, and yet it's a singular concept. So God who is seen in a plural way, but it's still one God. So we have, I think we have the idea of plurality and also singular. So it's a word that hints at both, because it's a person, but then there's plurality as well. So, and the other thing that we've seen is that El, it's derived from El, meaning mighty one. Okay, mighty one or strong. Okay, mighty one or strong. That's what I'd like you to. That's what I'd like you to settle on. And of course, the other interesting revelation of God being a Trinity. Please listen to that sermon for more of that, because he goes deeper into that. And this is beautiful. So, in the beginning, you know, in the beginning God created. You know, in the beginning God created. In the beginning God created. In the beginning Elohim. In the beginning God. Okay. In the beginning God. So it's a beautiful, beautiful. So the one who was there at the beginning. So oh my Elohim, oh you who are mighty and strong. Okay. That is something that we see now as a shift, and we'll see how relevant this is to the cries that are attached to it, because we see the cries are what? The cries are, let me not be put to shame. You who are very strong, you who are, in fact, you are there in the beginning God, even before the beginning, because that is a reference of time. You are there even before, as we saw in the previous one, to you, O Lord, the existing one. So David cries out to that God, that the one who was at the beginning, the mighty one, the strong one, the three in one, the God as he has revealed himself. And he says, in you I trust, in you I trust. How beautiful. This is a repetition of, it's a some of a repetition of the first verse, but using different concepts, just to, you know, inaonyesha the depth, inaonyesha yani vile umtu ameenda deep na God, because anatumia different words but to express the same thing. And tunapata hii idea from the word trust. Nakumbuka tuliona that last week. So he says, on, oh my God, in you I trust. There are other words in the psalm that talk about trust using a different word, and I'll just show you one. But you can look, you know, like apa unaweza kama search for trust. Okay, search for trust, then nime hit enter, then wakama hapa unasema nataka ku search for that word in Psalms, then you just apply, then utaona different usages of that same word. For example, Psalm 9:10 nasema, and those who know your name put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. Some trust in chariots, some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord. That's Psalm 27, you know, and so on and so forth. Okay, and the key thing I'd like you to see is that when you see how a word is used, then you understand it better. Okay, like trusting in the Lord means trusting in him alone. For example, in this Psalm 27, some trust in chariots, some trust in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord, our God. And we also see that it's possible for human beings to trust in other things. It's possible for them to trust in chariots. And the idea here by trusting in chariots and horses ni vitu zenye zinakaa ziko na nguvu, but hizo vitu ni created. That's now where I would like you to see the usage of Elohim and how relevant it is that David is not, no, and by David we are not called to trust in any created thing or to trust in anything that man has made or anything that is in man. But we are always, as Christians and as believers, we are always called up and we are always to be found confessing our trust in God. And you see that it's, oh my God, oh my strong one, oh my strong and mighty one, in you I put my trust, in you I trust. That's a beautiful thing. And then you see the same thing, because there's a part in Psalm 31:6 where he says, I hate those who pay regard to worthless idols, but I trust in the Lord. So the alternative of trusting in God is, you know, trusting in anything else, which is idolatry. So I encourage you to do this. Like if you see trust, come, look for it. I think even kwa apps mingi, kuna hiyo, you can search for a word and you can search it. The reason I'm searching in the psalm alone is because we are doing a psalm. So it's safe to do that, so that the psalm, you know, it's one book, so we search how is this word used in this book. Then you can even expand it. How is this word used in the whole Bible? Like that and like that. So we have that. And then the other thing about is important also, let me create a duplicate. The other thing that is also wonderful to note here is that, let me just bring it up. Psalm 25. The other thing that is important to note is what we went through also is that the idea of trusting, there's another word that is used for trusting. There's another symbol. You know, simple. Ni kama vile tunasemanga, unaweza sema kitu kama niliji, you know, nili take refuge, nilijifunikia pahali. So that idea of taking refuge is the other way in which we see trusting God put a lot of time in the psalm, and we saw it yesterday, like. And for that, let me also show you some examples. So I've just searched for refuge in Psalm, and there are many. So there are many, and the one that I'd like you to see is this one, for example. In the Lord, I take refuge. Then we have Psalm 31, I think, again. It says that, in you, O Lord, do I take refuge? And then we'll see it because of what he says next. Then be Psalm 31, 2, be a rock of refuge for me, a strong fortress to save me. Psalm 31, 4, you take me out of the net they have hidden for me, for you are my refuge. So the idea of refuge, maybe let me look for another one towards the end of the Psalms, like Psalm 71, I have been as potent to many, but you are my strong refuge. Then Psalm 73, 28, but for me it is good to be near God. I have made the Lord God my refuge, that I may tell of his works. And then maybe Psalm 91, to where the two are brought together, it says, I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. So refuge, fortress, trust, it's the same thing, but we are using different analogies. So mtu akisema, God is my fortress, unasema, I am trusting him. So unaangalia fortress, ni kama uangalie nyumba ama uangalie, you know, in times of war, watu walikuwa wanajifichanga chini ya, they used to dig and make very, you know, safes basically. Hata bomb ikitupwa haiwezi vunjika because it's made of very heavy metal and concrete and all those things. So that's the idea. So when you say my fortress, then you're looking at that, you know, that impenetrable safe place. Hiyo place yenye hawezi, kuna kinaweza ingia ikudhuru. Okay, ukiangalia God as my refuge, then uko ndani sasa, unasema yenyewe niko, you know, unaangalia kama iko ndani, kama uko ndani. So it's the same thing of trusting in the Lord, and that is what is being expressed here, that, oh my God, and it's a cry. This is a cry. Oh my God, in you I trust, in you I take refuge. Najificha ndani yako ili nisi, ili nisifanye nini, ili nisiaibike. And that brings us to the second part, where he says, let me not be put to shame. Now there's a lot to talk about, there's a lot to say about shame. So what I will do is, again, in the description box, I will link a resource that describes what shame is, okay, and why we need to be aware of it, and also why we need to respond correctly to it as Christians. So it's a story of it's a story in a book that I highly recommend to all of you, that is by John Bunyan, called Pilgrim's Progress. And so it's a story of Christian going from the town of destruction to the celestial city, basically his journey as a Christian. So there's one character, and so what he does is that he uses characters to show different aspects of challenges that we meet with. So one of the characters in that book is shame. Shame is described for us. And so the link is someone discussing that, okay? Someone discussing the application of that and how relevant it is to us. So please look at it, because there's much to say about this, but so that we can keep this short and accessible to young people, so we cannot talk about all of it in this section. But we can say two things about it. One is that shame, it often takes a negative and sinful meaning when we are ashamed of what is true. Okay, so when you are ashamed of, you know, that which is right, that which is good, then shame is evil. For example, in Hebrews 12:1-2, it says that Jesus, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame. Okay, he endured the cross, despising its shame, so that the shame of the cross was something that Jesus had to bear. So for him to bear that shame, he had to despise it for the joy set before him. Another example would be just from day-to-day life zetu. Mtu akikwambia I think tunatumianga ama tumeobserve hizi vitu, and we ask God to help us and save them from them, that saingine among youth tunakuanga tuna we shame one another, yani tunaibishana kwa mambo ambayo hatufai kuibishana. So for example, unapata mtu anachekelea beshte yake because beshte yake anaendanga church, ama unapata mtu anachekelea beshte yake because beshte yake amesikiza mamake ambaye anataka aende home mapema na asichelewe. So anamwambia msee, si wewe uko 40 ama msee, si wewe uko, you know, si uko 20, si uko na ndevu buda, bado uko na kafi, you know. So that kind of shame is wrong, because we are told to honor our parents, to obey them. Kama unaishi kwa your parents' house, then anasema, yeah, you know, kuja, you know, by 6, ukue home. That's a good thing to honor. So kuwa ashamed about that is sinful. Then kuna good kind of shame, ama shame that we should all have by God's grace. And isn't it? You know, we should be ashamed of doing that which is wrong. Okay, we should be ashamed of doing that which is wrong. So what David is praying for here is for him not to be put to shame. Asiaibishwe aje. So again, hii tunaangalia shame inatoka wapi. Okay, shame inatokanga wapi. And ukiangalia definition ya shame, actually, we can pull it up, shame definition. It talks about a painful feeling of humiliation or distress caused by consciousness of wrong. You know, aibu, mtu anaibikanga, either unaweza aibika kwa sababu ya wewe mwenyewe ndani yako, okay? The kitu yenye nataka muone ni consciousness of wrong. Ama unaweza aibishwa. So inaweza kuwa either ni watu nje ama ndani yako. But kuna vitu mingi zinaweza fanya tuaibike. Na kama vijana, ni kweli ya kwamba aibu zetu zinakuwa, you know, aibu zetu zinaweza kuwa ndani yetu. Kama siku hizi tunaibika sana kwa sababu ya vile tunakaa. Namaanisha most of us don't like the way we look. Tunaibika kwa sababu ya, unaweza aibika kwa sababu ya, you know, kule umetoka, background yako, unaweza aibika kwa sababu ya labda ushiki vitu haraka, you know, hii nafikiria story ya masomo. Unaweza aibika kwa sababu ya dhambi ambayo umetenda. So kuna kitu tu ulifanyanga, yani ukikumbuka unajawa na shame na guilt, na nazitumia hizo kama the same thing. So aibu inaweza toka ndani yako, hiyo ndio point ya kwanza. So tunaweza, kwa sababu Daudi yasemi ni nini haswa anaomba asiaibishwe nayo, tunaweza sema yeah, ni ukweli that tunataka kuokolewa na hiyo dhambi. Mungu usiache niibike. Mungu niokoe na hizo aibu zangu, aibu zenye niko nazo ndani yangu. Niokoe. Alafu kuna hii nyingine ya aibu ya kushindwa, na hiyo tunaiona tukisoma the next verse, that anaomba let not my enemies exalt over me. So anaomba ushindi, na Mungu ametupa tiba ndani ya neno lake. Kwa sababu kumbuka, aibu inatokana na nini? Aibu inatokana na kile ambacho tunaamini. So tukiamini ya kwamba, for example, tukiamini ya kwamba vile nakaa, okay, physical appearance, tukiamini ya kwamba physical appearance, I must always look handsome, or if you are ready, I must always look beautiful. And what does beauty mean? So kuna mtu atakwambia what beauty means. So kuna mtu atakuja kwambia beauty means, if you're a young man, beauty means having a lot of money. And I think umesikia hii. If you're a woman, beauty means a certain figure, or beauty means a certain face, or a certain skin tone. So ukiamini hiyo, then the moment hatuna hizo vitu, tutakuwa ashamed. So one of the ways God answers this for us is that he teaches us his truth. And to show you this, I'd like you to consider one story where we see Jesus dealing with shame. Do you want it? That it is possible to become a victor over sin. So this is Luke 16 from verse... He tells them a parable of the dishonest manager. Please read it. Then once he told them that story, he's declaring God's truth. So an example of that for us would be that uenda useme mtu akwambie, by the way, mapua yako ni kubwa. Then ikusumbue bwana, ikusumbue, because hizi vitu zinatusumbuanga kama young people. So inisumbue sana. Then uambie, no, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. So it's something like that had happened to Jesus. So he had just told them a truth. And just to give you a hint, he said that no servant can serve two masters. That is verse 13, Luke 16, 13. No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. You see, that is a truth. Hawezi fuata Mungu na pesa. Either unafuata Mungu ama unafuata pesa. So Pharisees walikuwa wanafuata pesa, but wanasema wanafuata Mungu. So wanasema, then verse 14 says that the Pharisees, who were lovers of money, had all these things and they ridiculed him. Basically, they wanted to shame Jesus. Okay, an example again to keep for two example yetu. So ni hiyo inaweza kuwa sema useme kama lady umeambiwa, umeenjoy about your mapua yako ni kubwa. Inakaa tu iko wifi kwa hiyo sura. Then umambie mtu, mimi Bible inaambia, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Then an example of a ridicule would be, lakini watu wengine wako more fearfully than wonderfully made. You see, that's not what the word of God says. So it's a ridicule. And the idea is that, wanataka watu wacheke, and then we waibike. You get? And that's exactly what is there in verse 15. He says, and he said to them, you are those who justify yourselves before men. The idea of justifying yourselves before men ni mnataka watu mnataka acceptance ya watu. So acceptance ya watu ni aka kamtu kamoja kanasema ati ninyi ni mbaya, mbona asumbuliwi na hiyo mapua? Na hiyo mapua hii si kama hii according to people sio beautiful. So they ridicule. Okay? So the first thing Jesus does is he recognizes that. He recognizes that their heart is not on God. Their heart is on, one, money. They are lovers of money. And then number two, their heart is seeking the approval of men. Yani, watu wakisema, ukopoa, then unafry. Ama watu wakisema, yay to you, then unafry. Watu wakisema, mbaya, then, you basically, acceptance ya watu ndio, they feed on that. And then he goes on and says, God knows your heart. So basically that it's not right with God. The heart is set on idols. And then this is something that now Jesus says as a response. He says that for what is exalted among men is an abomination in the sight of God. So what can you ningependa uone ni that God gives us his truth as one of the ways to keep us from being ashamed. Because there's a certain kind of shame we should not feel as Christians. I should not be ashamed of my physical appearance because it's not what Hollywood says it should be. I should not, because God tells me, I've made you fearfully and I've made you wonderfully. No, we should not be ashamed about, for example, here, we should not be ashamed of the fact that we do not serve God and money because, well, we want to honor God. A final example is when Prophet Samuel went to anoint David. You remember the, you know the story to wanafunzi wa Sunday school. So alienda akaona firstborn akasema, "Wow! Hey, huyu jamaa anakaa kuwa king." Mungu akamwambia nini? No, I have not chosen him because man sees what is outside. Man looks at the physical appearance or man sees on the surface, but God looks at the heart. Okay, so, and that is the truth. But you see, everything around us wants to shame us based on what is, quote, exalted among men. What is exalted among men ni appearances. Vitu za nje. Vitu za nje. Vitu za nje ndio exalted. So that kama hauna hizo vitu, una live all your life ukiwa ashamed. So the one thing is that we should not be ashamed. That is not the shame that David is talking about here. Yeah? And even if it, and since he does not explicitly say, then we know that what we ought to pray to God for is, God, sanctify me in your truth. No, sanctify me in your truth. Sanctify me in your word, which is truth. That, Lord, I may never be ashamed of your truth. But I, like you, may despise that kind of shame. And for the joy set before me, because you tell me that whatever is exalted among men is an abomination to God, I don't want to be an abomination to you. I want to please you. So help me, Lord, not even to feel that kind of shame, to be able to despise it with my God, because we will be shamed. It's a fact. So that one, that's how we deal with it. Then there's the, so let me not be put to shame. What does God do? God does what he's doing to us right now. He teaches us his word so that I know the truth, so that I can look at it, smile, reiterate the truth, and move on with my God happily. I can despise the shame for the joy set before me. And I can endure that cross because it is a cross and it's painful to be ashamed. It hurts kuaibishwa. Kuaibishwa mbele ya watu, kuaibishwa mbele za watu wenye ulikuwa unafikiria ni marafiki ama watu wenye ni marafiki zako because of taking certain stance. But it is okay. It's okay to do so because God looks at your heart. And if your heart is right with God, and if you're trusting him and you're not looking for the approval of people, then you will experience that shame as a purifying, it will help you to trust God more. Perhaps this is what David was feeling. Okay. The other thing, of course, is there's also the idea that we brought about of it might be shame inside me. It is a shame that I am supposed to be feeling. Okay, the shame of I've done wrong. Okay, and this brings me now to the other idea that it might be the shame, this shame that David is talking about. It might be the shame that comes from my sins. And we are all sinful. And we'll see how that gets dealt with below decisively. For now, I'd like to suggest to you a verse in 2 Peter, 1 Peter, sorry, 1 Peter 2:24. Please look it up where it says that Jesus bore our sins on the cross. Jesus himself bore our sins on the, let me just open it. 1 Peter 3, 1 Peter 2. Let me just open the whole of it. 1 Peter 2:24, where it says that he himself, talking about Jesus, in fact, we can start from above so that you see the context. So he says he committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. And then when he was reviled, reviling, reviling, ni kutukanwa. It's very shameful kutukanwa, by the way. You've seen people fight because wametukanana. So when he was reviled, when he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he continued doing what? Look at this and see the links between this and what we're doing. He continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He kept, in fact, we can use it in our verse, he kept lifting up his soul to God. How beautiful. God help us to respond this way to all such kind of things that we'll meet. And then this is now the part. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. Hallelujah. By his wounds, you have been healed. This is talking about more than just being healed from physical disease. He's talking about being healed from sin. from sin so that we live to righteousness. And the sin that we are looking at here is the sin of shame, that I am ashamed, Lord. Father, my sins, the shame itself is a sin. The shame is because of my sins. And Lord, I need healing. That is the cry of this man, that Lord, let me not be ashamed. I am trusting you, oh my God. You are the strong one. You are the mighty one. Lord, you can deal with my sin. Lord, you can teach me your truth so that I am able to despise all shame that I don't need to feel. Father, you can do it. That's the spirit of this trust. And then finally, he also talks about victory. This is a person that is crying out for victory. And who cries out for victory if there's no element of defeat? You know, let not my enemies exult over me. Is a person in trouble. You know, kiangalia around you, there are a lot of things as young people that just come to kutushinda. We live in an age of depression. We live in an age of sexual immorality. We live in an age of pride. We live in an age of disobedience to parents. That is the age we are living in. And so sin is a powerful force. Sin is so powerful that we ought and we have and we are and we will be crying this way, that let not my enemies exalt me. So there's an enemy of sin. Second, there's an enemy of the devil. The devil is real. He's not a storybook. He's a real enemy. And if you want more on that, go read Ephesians 6:10 downwards. You see how Paul describes those enemies, that they are spiritual rulers, you know, heavenly forces in, you know, heavenly powers in the spirit. You know, you go read those terms. So there's that enemy. And a friend of mine was telling me, you know, the enemy, the devil has been around for so long. He has seen, he saw Adam and Eve fall. He saw all the people, you know, kama unaweza fikiria, mtu ako na experience, ni nini hajaona? Well, unaweza mshinda aje. In fact, someone rebuked me one day. Akaniambia, you know, Wallace, you need to get serious. Because, and he told me in mother tongue, and what he meant is that the devil is not an uncircumcised boy. He's a real, strong, crafty enemy. And if God does not help us against the enemy, tutashindwa. So this cry must go up. Let not my enemies exult over me. And look now at this. Who are we crying to? Oh my God, the strong one. The stronger one than the devil. If he helps me, if he helps you, you will not be defeated. Remember, exult over me, hautashindwa. Enemies wako hawata kushinda. And then finally, kuna the world system. So there's sin itself, there's a devil, and there's a system of the world, you know. And that's why we are told, remember, we looked at, you know, do not love the world. It does not mean the physical things of the world. When it says do not love the world or the things in the world, the idea is that word world, okay, it includes the things of the world, yeah, but the world is a system, the attitudes of the world. And it's some of those that we saw when we were looking at shame. Attitudes of the world is, you can serve both God and money. Do not love that. Don't agree with that. You know, resist it inside and how you live. So the nakwambia hizi ni complicated because ni my ideology. To give you an example of one, ni na lazima umesikia, for example, watu wakisema ati ni sawa, you know, like when they want to cause us to doubt our faith. So they'll tell you something like, yeah, you know me, I believe in a higher power. Okay? Or I believe in many ways. You know, there are many ways. I mean, there are many ways to save yourself. There are many ways to get saved. You know, everyone, there are no bad people. you know, the world, I will tell you that, yeah, you know, YOLO. YOLO is also something of the world, that you only live once. And of course, you know how it's used, is that because of that, therefore, live recklessly. It's never used like you only live once, or live, you know, ishi vizuri, ishi kama mtu anajua penye anafanya. No, no. Inatumikanga kutufanya as young people too. Tuishi tu, you know, yeah, wild and all that. And those are their worldly systems. For the one that we looked at again, which is that we should only focus on the outside. That is again, it's a pattern of the world, and it's also what is talked about in Romans, so that do not conform to the pattern of this world. That's what we mean. That's an enemy to us. Because once we buy into those ideas, then tutashindwa. You know, our enemies will exalt over us, because the world is passing away along with all its desires. So, ata sisi tutapass away. And no one wants to pass away. We want to endure until, you know, forever. So, when David cries this, he cries against those enemies. In this verse, perhaps, since God allowed us to see physical enemies, so in the Old Testament, the direct match of the time, the direct references, they must have been, and they may have been, a physical enemy that, you know, because David was on the run, as you can remember the stories of him being, you know, King Saul wanting to kill him and all. But in the spiritual sense, which is what is intendment, it is what is intended, those are the three enemies, and we ought, and we are, and we should, and we are crying to the Lord that, oh my God, oh Elohim, oh my Elohim, personal God, not, it's a God, my God, in you I trust. Lord, I'm hiding in you. Lord, I'm taking refuge in you. Father, don't let me be put to shame. Father, sort out all these sins in my life, because you tell me that you bore my sins on the cross. Father, do not teach me your truth. You know, help me, you know, sanctify me in your truth, that I may know what is true, believe what is true, and be bold against anything that might cause me shame, that you do not call me to have. And the final one is that, let not my enemies exalt over me. Don't let them exalt over me, Lord. Don't let them exalt over me. But rather, give me victory. Don't let the devil exalt over me. Usiache nishindwe na shetani. Mungu wangu, usiache dhambi yangu inishinde. Na usiache nishindwe na hii system ya hii dunia. You know, ujanja wa hii dunia, nikomboe na hayo yote. That is what we are praying for. That is what we are hoping in. That is what we are crying out to the Lord for. And even in these other things, like victory in our work, victory in our studies, victory, you know, even those other victories, we have the assurance that if we seek first the kingdom of God, then all those other things will be added unto us. And we bless you, Lord. We thank you, Father, for your word, which is a light unto our feet. And we pray that you may make these things real in our lives, to the glory and honor of your name, to the glory of honor of Christ who bore our sins, O Lord, to the glory of honor of Christ who bore our sins, that we may die to sin and live to righteousness. We ask you to heal us of all shame. We ask you to teach us your truth, that we may know you. And we ask that you would give us victory, O Lord, in every area. And once you give us victory, that you would keep us humble, Lord. We bless you, Lord, and we thank you. And we ask all this, that you may make these things true once more. We ask and plead in the power of your Holy Spirit, to the glory and honor of your name, and to our good, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you, and God keep you.